Hello and welcome to Audiovisual Cultures, the podcast that explores different areas of the arts, media and cultural production. I'm Paula Blair and today I'm catching up with Brendan Conley, who featured in episode 79 back in 2020, talking about the mystery audio drama series Circles, written by Brendan during the first pandemic lockdown. If you didn't hear that one, do go back and listen and give Circles a try too. It's along the lines of what would Scooby-Doo and the Mystery Machine Bunch be up to as grown-ups and had to confront the repercussions of their meddling. It's really good fun, it's really mysterious, and it's very well constructed and the sound design's brilliant, so do check it out. The links for those are all in the show notes. Huge thanks to our fab patrons over at patreon.com/AVCultures. Without their support and all of you listening, I'd be just a mad woman in the attic talking to herself. So thank you so much for letting me be part of your world. Speaking of worlds, we're going to hear about Brendan's latest project, the fantasy Choose Your Own Adventure Advent Calendar. Yes, that will all make sense as we go through, and it's called The Ticking World. We also go on a little bit of a tangent about cinema, so do enjoy all of that and let us know what you think on our socials, and those are all in the show notes as well. Do have fun with this one. Brendan Conley, welcome back.
Yeah, pleased to be back.
It's brilliant to have you. We spoke around this time last year about your spooky audio drama series, Circles, which I enjoyed very much and people should go and listen to if they haven't already. We're going to speak about something quite different and new that you've been working on. What would you think you would like to tell us about The Ticking World?
So what it is a calendar, and it's also a branching narrative. Like the brand name everybody knows, the trademarked brand name everybody knows, is Choose Your Own Adventure. So the Choose Your Own Adventure books here in the UK, the fighting fantasy books and various other series over the years have been known of game books, and these are the sort of narratives which tend to be, do you know what, I've completely drawn a blank on what tense it would be. Is it second person? I suppose it's you do this, you do that, you climb a ladder. They're works of fiction in which the reader is presented with a series of choices at the end of different passages. So if you were to pick up a Choose Your Own Adventure book, you would start on entry one, and then at the end it might say, if you want to go on the bus with Jane, go to page 38. If you want to stay home with Kate, go to page 114. And as you go through, a narrative comes to light. And I've taken that and I've put it in the shape of a calendar so that each of the paths has to last the same duration. And the idea is that the reader reads a page each day. And I'm not entirely sure where it started, Paula, but there is something there about choose your own advent, choose your own adventure, the idea of advent calendars. And I was thinking at first of an advent calendar with little windows on, you know the things. And would it be possible to sort of do a sort of a web across one of those where people choose their path? But it sort of evolved into something with a lot more prose in it. So it's now fully illustrated, and each day of the month you will in fact have multiple pages, and you will end up turning to the last page on the day and leaving that displayed as your illustrated calendar page for that day of December and taking a choice at the bottom. So formally speaking, that's what it is, but that doesn't really tell us much about what it really is.
I wonder if, because you leave it overnight, say, before you go on to the next one, you've got quite a while to mull it over, your choice.
Yes.
You could change your mind. This is interesting. This is a different spin on this.
Well, I remember as a kid learning chess. My family's rules for chess were, if you've got your hand still on the piece, you can take the move back, right?
So right.
As long as you haven't removed your hand from the piece, you can take the move back. And I suppose the house rule here might be, as long as you haven't turned the page, you haven't made your choice yet. But at the moment you turn the page, there's no going back. But everybody knows with these game books that you keep your thumb in case you don't like the passage you turn to. Everybody knows that this is common practice with readers, and I think that's something interesting about them, really, because instead of giving you a linear narrative in which things unfold, you do this sort of way of cheating, I suppose, opens up this sort of sense of parallel diverging paths to you. And I suppose in the sense that you're aware of their being parallel and diverging paths because you're being offered them, but you get some sense of what they are if you cheat. Not that I'm encouraging cheating. I will say, not to give too much away, after you've played this once, I would like to think that you could put it away and come back to it next year, hang it on the wall and take a different path, make some different choices. And do you know what? If you don't want to play it December, you want to play it in April, or you want to play it all on one day, I'm not going to stop you. But it is designed to facilitate day-by-day play, so you spend 25 days in this world.
And the world that you've mentioned, what kind of world is this? Because it's not quite our world. It's a little bit different, isn't it?
It's really not our world. It might look like it. It's sort of set in a sort of a notional north. I'm sort of interested in these ideas of north. We think of cold and snow and aurora borealis and the North Star and these cultural ideas that seeped into things like Philip Pullman's books or even Narnia. And it seems to be a sort of a non-denominational fantasy of winter in a way. It's an exploration of these ideas of North. Literally, you're wandering around exploring these ideas of the North. So I've taken things from fables, I've taken things from folklore, and I've created something new. And particular and specific, and the further you go into it, the more some of the particulars of this fantasy world help you navigate it a little bit, for want of a better way of expressing it without spoiling anything. But you'll start to recognize terms and things like that. So, for example, Paul, if we were to go and pick up, we would go to a bookstore, we'd pick up 10 fantasy novels and bring them home, we'd sort of have some sort of sense of what a goblin might be, right? But in each of those worlds, goblin might be something slightly different. So the word goblin does not appear in the Ticking World, but if it did, it would mean a particular thing, and it would be, you know, you get a better idea of what it particularly means in this world as the narrative goes on. So yes, it's a sort of a designed fantasy world that sort of does the old sci-fi trick of taking it for granted that you know what these words are, so you encounter them enough times that sooner or later you do know what these words are. It's sort of full immersion, I think, is the policy there. So this northern world, and it begins with the explorer, the reader, who is not in any way defined or described. You imagine them as yourself or whoever you wish them to be, exploring the north, and they hear a ticking and they go to investigate this ticking, and the story is driven by that noise. And I'm perilously close to giving away some things that might affect people's choices, so I don't want to, but it's sort of a virtue of this format, really, that all sorts of things can be left ambiguous, really. And when I say you to somebody, I don't want to impose any notion of gender or age or of race or ethnicity, even background. This person could literally be anybody. And I think that became a bit of a puzzle in the writing at times, because then I started thinking, well, what if it's a person with a form of disability, really? And I don't want them to sort of take for granted that, you know, there's this risk in a lot of media or stories that try to be diverse that they overlook some of these things. And it kind of becomes impossible at a point to be all things. So I suppose, in a sense, there are some limitations on who the character is, because they need to be someone who can enact all of the choices. And sometimes I suppose that comes down to you're making a choice between them being, let's just say, positive or negative, and the choice you make defines who they are. But in reality, there are myriad choices someone could make in a lot of these situations, and I've limited them, obviously, to find out. This is not a mile thick, this calendar. It's pretty chunky, but there are limited choices that are available. So in a sense, I had to sort of wake up to the fact that some of the choices, both physically but also sort of behaviorally, that are left to the explorer, player, reader to choose, would create some sort of boundaries to what the character is. But I didn't want those to be along normal lines of limited or presumptive representation, really.
Yes, I noticed that you very kindly sent me a bit of a preview, an early draft of, well, the first few pages, really, of an earlier draft. So I've got a good sense of that. Will anyone you as the protagonist has to encounter, well, there is no sense of gender or what they might look like.
Yes.
It's just a very blank, right, you're talking to a person and that's yes. It. And I appreciated that, actually. I really like that. I think that's a very thoughtful decision. One thing you did, though, that isn't so kind is that you've left me at a very exciting point where I'm going, right, well, this is just kicking off now and I don't know what happens next. So you've done that quite well. You've tantalized me. I was wanting to ask you, the illustrations are so important. I kind of raced through just reading the text and then I realized, no, I need to actually take a moment to look through these really gorgeous illustrations that are with each page, because I think there's information in there. Am I on the right lines there with that?
Yeah. So this is a big subject, actually, Paula. I think the first thing to say about the illustrations, they're done by Maya Evans, who is tremendous. Early in development, we looked at a few different styles. The one we decided to go with and the one that Maya has executed is sort of inspired really in a sense by this adventurer were to keep a sketchbook or to bring one back. So there's a sort of a strong sense of a sort of a journal or a chronicle here, which sort of plays into the calendar format. There's a sort of a log being kept in the images. And it's quite right that actually, to a lesser and greater extent with different images, there is information in the images that should reveal more about this world. And depending on how you interpret it, influence some of the choices you've made. Now, am I to say there's a right or a wrong choice and that an image can give you a clue to the right choice? I don't think that's actually quite right. Again, it would spoil too much to get too far into that, but there's certainly things in the images that can be reflected upon and quite literally interpreted, I'd say. Yeah, so you've seen something. I'm curious, what did you see that you thought might constitute extra information in the images or a clue of some description?
I'm not sure much to say. I can cut this out if this gives too much away, but there's a moment where the adventurer is in one of the choices, walking on ice, and sees something in the ice.
Right, right.
If that's all right to say.
That's fine, you can say that.
I won't say what it is, but I just feel that there might be some idea of what could be going on. The bigger picture of what could be going on, I get a feeling from that, or it could be just a total deflection or something. I don't know, but I saw that image was very interesting, if you know the one I'm talking about.
I know exactly the image you're talking about. I'd say that some of the images contain interpretable clues. The images are thematically relevant, and some of the images, which means that sometimes you'd be presented with a choice where you can reflect on something you saw in another image and say, well, I think I learned that I'm going to make this choice. And at other times, I think we're just sort of digging down to what's below the surface, or really subtext is perhaps too strong a word for what's fundamentally a light adventure story, really. But yeah, there are ideas in the images. And I think what you are speaking to there is a sense of, now that you've seen that image, something that's going on takes on an extra level of meaning for you. And had you not seen it, then it wouldn't. But you may have seen something else that would create a different. So that's what we're sort of playing with there, really. So some of the images add levels of sort of story interpretation, and some might influence choices.
I'm thinking as well in terms of maybe the idea of time travel and the path not taken. I think, as you said, you know, you can go back and you can play it again and you can take the path that you didn't take before. So it feels a bit time travel-y if you think about it in those terms. That's probably just me overloading on sci-fi at the moment.
Well, putting dates on the pages certainly leads to those sort of associations as much as anything else. Yeah, I mean, you know, one thinks of Doc Brown's diagram on a chalkboard with time skewing off at a tangent. And to talk a little about how this was planned, I've got a flowchart that looks like a very complicated version of that, really. This is a tree. You start at a single point and then it branches and it branches and it branches. And, you know, the multiverse model, this notion of parallel timelines, is exactly this, right? It's choices or interactions create, you know, alternative actualities. So, yeah, I think coded into Choose Your Own Adventure books is always these ideas of what could have been. But I think because what's unique about an advent calendar as opposed to a calendar is a calendar will take several years to come around again until its dates line up with the days. But as long as we keep the same number of days in December, which I suspect for quite some time we'll be doing that, it's annually useful. You know, there's no reference to what day of the week you're on. So in a sense, it's a trip you can take annually, totally within its design. It's very much reusable. Nothing gets torn or ripped. And though it sort of does encourage you to write things down or take notes or indeed do your own sketches, you don't have to do that on the calendar itself. I mean, you can just do that on a sketchbook or on a notepad. So it remains intact, really.
And it's not necessarily festive. You know, you don't have to adhere to, say, a Christian calendar or anything. It's just its own story and it's just happening to take place.
Yeah, I think it's just this idea of North. I think of all these American TV shows where they say holiday special and they're sort of allergic to the word Christmas. And I don't mean this in any way to sort of infract upon people with faith, but the word Christmas has a lot of secular power as well, right? I mean, it means a lot to people who don't celebrate as Christians. It's, and though the word Christmas doesn't appear anywhere in this, the notion that we have a winter festival, you know, and I mean this in a way that's supportive of or sort of buttresses the sort of Christian Christmas. It's not undermining that, but sort of ancillary to its side. There is still, you know, it's Christmas, it's time for Advent. And in fact, one of the early pieces of research I did into this was looking into who liked Advent calendars, why they got them, what they did with them. And, you know, because there hasn't been one like this, I think people like the idea of ritual, having something to do every day. And I think a lot of people just like getting a little chocolate from the advent calendar, right? We're quite familiar now with the ones that contain little toys and chocolate. And this does not contain chocolate, I'm afraid to say. But the idea that every day there is something there for you. And, you know, the original idea, as I said, there was going to be no text, but a series of small images. And we, you know, we've come on to something much bigger. And I think the difference is with those small images, it didn't feel like you were being given much on a day. You know, Maya and myself want people to enjoy each day. You find out the answer to what would happen. It's what would happen, what would happen. The all-time narrative hook is what's going to happen, right? That's what powers every story. What happens next? And the cheap way to get stakes in something like this is it's in the hands of the reader explorer. So their actions do have repercussions. So immediately, straight away, there is some interest in, well, what's going to happen because I've made this choice? So every day it does deliver that. But every day we deliver at least one, again, not to spoil anything, but at least one of Maya's images. And I'd like to think the best, you haven't seen the best yet. They come a little later. There's some things to move towards. And the story sort of starts to click into place and you get all of the rewards of a story. And one of the things I was quite keen to do, Paula, was to think about, even though it's branching, how can I make sure that these stories have a structure that feels satisfying to people? It follows, I think, conventional narrative practice of a story with a beginning, a middle, and an end, and something in the middle changes, shifts your perspective significantly. And as you get towards the end, things seem to be more fraught and the hope goes out of the picture a little bit, yet you can rally round and resolve things. There's quite a sort of a, you know, there's a story structure here that is familiar from thousands of years of stories. It doesn't wander from that because you're making these choices. And two of the things I was quite adamant that it was going to do the jugs I wanted it to fit into was 25 days for Advent. So no matter what path you know, you don't reach a dead end on day 17. You just can't. And there are some choose your own adventure books where your choices might take you four passages in, and some might take you 54 passages in. Here, you're moving through 25 days. Not always 25 pages, but 25 days. Also, you know, the sense of a story unfolding. It's not stop, start. It's got a flow and it's not just a broken series of episodes, really. That's the ambition anyway.
Would you like to receive updates, links and special offers straight to your inbox? Then visit audiovisualcultures.wordpress.com to sign up to our mailing list. A couple of things that really strike me is that it is on paper. It's a physical calendar. It's not digital. The choice of that, I mean, so many of us have had to spend a lot of our lives the past couple of years on our computers. So it feels quite refreshing. It almost feels like part of a resistance against the digital in a sense. There's that. And then the feeling of them being drawings. There's almost that liveness to it. You're being taken on that journey and the choices that you have to make. You know, you're autonomous to a degree in the story. You're not a passive reader or consumer. You are an active agent in the story. And I think those are things, yeah, that really stand out for me about this project.
And they're not disassociated ideas, actually, because to be the most engaged, you would do things like take notes, and that would be a physical act. So if you do keep a notepad, and I mean, it does ask you to keep up. So again, very simply at the start, you're told a few items you have in your inventory, and as you go through the story, you will lose and acquire other items. So at the most simple level, you're keeping a record of, I have a small lamp, I'm carrying this, that, or the other, not to spoil any of the objects encountered, but you keep a total of those, and those can influence the choices that are available to you at different points. So, for example, if you've got a big gold key and you come across a big gold padlock, you can unlock it, and if you don't, you cannot. So at the most basic level, yes, you actually do a physical something, but there are other things you may wish to record and write down or draw at various points. You know, I don't know if it's necessarily sort of resistance to digital through and through, because there is a bit of me that thinks if an audience wants this digitally, then they should be able to have it. And that's sort of one of the big debates, I think, in media very much at the moment. So compare this to cinema. It's like, well, film shouldn't be getting released homes immediately. Why is this available for streaming at the same time as in cinema? And it's like, well, in a sense, that's a form of just democratic access, really. There are people who could not or would not choose to go to the cinema. And I think if cinema can't survive, and I love cinema above all else, I love it above all else, but I haven't been since before the pandemic, and I'm not entirely sure I'm about to hurry back. But if cinema can't exist and survive on its own terms, it doesn't have a God-given right to, I don't think. I find it very difficult to believe that cinemas will close and never reopen, as long as somebody wants cinemas to be open. Now, they may become expensive. They may become prohibitively expensive. One thinks of how much it can cost to go to the theatre sometimes. But if movies are made with suitable economics in mind, because one has to remember that a cinema doesn't keep much of the ticket price portion at all. Most of it's given away to the distributor. Mm-hmm. So let's just say that economically a film exists to be on streaming services. And in terms of its income, the cinema is a cherry on top. Then cinema can be priced viably for an audience still. So in my mind, if audiences want to stay home and watch a film on Netflix, that's great. That's fantastic. That's not to say they should be entitled to it at the same time. These are, you know, we're living in capitalism, Paula, and if we're going to play by any of those rules, I kind of really wish we didn't play by any of them, but if we are going to play by any of those rules, then, you know, I want James Bond at home now, so I'm going to steal it. It just isn't, I mean, it's literally theft. But I would love to stay home and watch a very large number of films at home rather than in cinema, because cinema is not to a suitable presentation standard at the moment, or wasn't. I was being disturbed. The projection was often bad. Audiences were unruly. Cinemas have got to learn the hard way that they've got to do this stuff right to survive. Then they're going to have to just learn the hard way. But it was a race to the bottom in cinemas, I think, really. Mm. And it's an industry that's sort of getting mired in a lot of novelty, a lot of things like secret cinema, where you go and you watch some Amtrak people being underpaid and exploited to dress up in cosplay and disrupt a badly projected film being played through awful speakers in the middle of a field somewhere, or so on. You know, I don't want to go to the cinema and sit by people eating their meals in a cinema. That's another thing that's being offered. So, you know, cinema's making the wrong choices. And what it really needs to do is it really needs to present a vast array of films, or a suitable array of films presented perfectly at an affordable price, and stamp down on people talking and using their phones in the film. I mean, it's really that simple. And here we are talking about an advent calendar, and somehow I've brought it around to this.
No, I love it.
But I think the idea is the same for me. If people would like this calendar as a digital item, I think I'm going to probably try and find some way to make that happen, actually.
Even if it was a print your own version of it or something.
I think it's conceived as a physical item. It's intended to be something that hangs on your wall, and you come back and you see it there a couple of times in the day, and you think about your choice. And, you know, you only give this thing, I'm not expecting people to sit in front of this calendar stroking their chin for an hour every day. There's a short paragraph or four to read on every page. You get the next step of the story, you get an image, you reflect upon it, that's it. It requires that bit more engagement than popping a chocolate out and putting it in your mouth, but you're not reading a book of a chapter of a novel every day. But it's nice, I think, that it is physically there, and it has the function of telling you what day in December it is, but also Maya's lovely pictures just brightening up the area as well, and sort of reminding you of this thing. So it is supposed to be a sort of a part-time companion. And I think, in a way, one of the things I often thought about this was about casual gamers playing on mobile phones, and how you get on a bus and you get like a 3 minute, and how things are quite pick up and play. So in a sense, this was designed to be kind of pick up and play. You come to it at the point that's convenient for you on the day, you enjoy it for a moment, and then you play again. It's not like sitting down for 3 hours to try and plow through, I don't know, the next Legend of Zelda game or something like that. It takes up a different space in your in one's life, I think, really.
I like the idea that you could pack it away with your, if you do Christmas decorations, for example, you could pack it away with your Christmas decorations and reuse it year after year after year. The way we probably did when we were younger, you had your regular ornaments and your decorations and everything. There are calendars I remember from when I was a kid that didn't have chocolate in them, but it was, you opened a nice picture every day and that sort of thing. So I quite like that idea of it, that it's not just this disposable thing full of plastic that's going into a landfill. It can be something that can be passed on, actually, maybe down a family, and people can do it together or they can do it on their own. It's a really lovely idea.
I think it's got a deliberately timeless choices in the sort of setting and in the tone. It's not topical in any way. I don't think this would have been impossible 20, 30, 40 years ago to see this same story told in a similar way. And therefore, I don't think it's going to wear out either. So I would like to think that people would get more than one run through this. And it is, it does invite you to want to find out what might have happened. And as I said, I'm not stopping anyone sitting there on December the 1st and doing every day's worth at once. We can't say no, but it's designed to facilitate one day at a time, December after December after December. And I suppose, in a way, it's quite nostalgic, and that's quite a nostalgic practice. And I think the idea of this sort of seasonal story is quite nostalgic anyway. I evoked Narnia or the Snow Queen or things like that when we were talking about this idea of a north before. The tone we've adopted here does sort of fit with that same sort of nostalgic sense. So if one read the Snow Queen or had the Snow Queen read to them as a child, then I think it's evoked some of those, quite deliberately evoked some of those same ideas. And I think that brings to mind a point that it's not aimed at a young reading age per se, but there isn't a bottom age for this. If you want to sit with your child and make these choices with them, it works perfectly fine. I think one would compare the prose in it to sort of a YA level of prose, but the subject matter is much more sort of all age appropriate. One of the interesting things about making something like this, one of the challenges in making something like this, was how do you make it not only satisfying now, but how do you give the suggestion that there's satisfaction to be had from doing it again? How do you let people know, right? You prove to yourself that it's satisfying to do it twice by doing it twice, but how do you heavily suggest to someone that? What I think's quite important branching narratives generally is to make the choices feel like they've got weight before you take them. So when you're presented with a choice, you get some sense of weight. And I think most stories tell you how to read them in the first sections, right? So if you're reading a novel, Paula, you sort of learn what novel you're reading in the first chapter. So the first few days of this should teach you, in some sense, that there is weight to these decisions, and these decisions to start feeling like they've got mass or importance before you make them, and then delivering on that later down the line. I think it's important to not make all of the repercussions immediate. It's not a series of what I did today affects tomorrow and only tomorrow. It's the choice I make today can have repercussions at any point during the remainder of the narrative. And as long as it ties back and there's a sort of a strong narrative thread that the cause and effect are really clear, then it really pays off on the stakes that are established by the choice and the cause. And here we go. We're talking about an advent calendar. I have to keep reminding myself that it's first and foremost, it's supposed to be fun, really. But if the choices all seemed entirely flippant, I think it would be much less satisfying.
Yeah, there are choices that are presented, certainly in the early part that I've seen so far, that seem that they're not maybe that huge a deal, but then a couple of days later, you go, oh, okay. It is that idea of, right, okay, maybe I need to just take more time to think through my decision. So you even have a choice in how you make your choices. Are you going to just go, right, intuitively, this is what I'm deciding and that's what I'm doing, and no deliberation? Or are you going to, maybe there's a group of you or a couple of you, and you go, right, if we do that, what if something like this happens? Or, so you go off and you have your own contingencies that you come up with. And maybe that says a bit about how my brain works, but I'm the sort of person who does that anyway. And I think it'd be a nice idea if there's anyone who hasn't got such neurodivergences, It'd be a nice idea for you to play something like this to show you what it's like to have a brain like that, where you're going, this is the network of all the stuff that could possibly happen in the next 10 years, you know?
Well, I think you're speaking to how my brain works, yeah. Actually, Paula. So maybe in a sense that this is an act of catharsis, I suppose, in a sense, creating something like this, bringing other people into this sort of worldview. A few years ago, I wrote a feature film screenplay which contains a murder mystery plot. And when I was giving it to readers to get notes early on, I gave them it in installments. And the reason I gave it to them in installments is at each of these points, I wanted to know that they didn't know what was coming ahead, but I needed to take their temperature on what they thought was coming ahead. Because particularly with a murder mystery, or particularly with any form of mystery or something that hangs on a form of twist, you need to know that you've established people's preconceptions correctly, mm-hmm. I think, really, and that you've tricked them into making the right assumptions. And if I gave them the whole thing, they might reflect on the entire narrative in a way that isn't particularly accurate mm-hmm. to their experience as they're going through it. But by stopping them and by pHing their reaction at each of these points, I got quite a clear read on which clues were too obvious, which clues were not obvious enough. And that helped me sort of calibrate sort of how sections were told, really. And I suppose that was a sort of a diagnostic tool for that has no relationship with the sort of, it does have a clear relationship with how people really do experience the product, because you are thinking in real time as you're watching a feature film, but you don't stop and necessarily just go. In fact, here I am. We were talking about streaming video. I think actually perhaps that happens much more now than it did in the past. People pause things, movies, and, mm-hmm. and have a talk. And we're in quite an episodic time for our big narratives at the mm-hmm. moment, really. One has to just look on Reddit at all the boards that look at things like Westworld, deconstructing where the plot might be going or what's going to happen. And I think a lot of TV series, even though they're delivered for one series at a time viewing at the moment, do encourage that sort of discussion between episodes. And I suppose, in a way, this day-by-day series of choices sort of does enable us to act upon those sort of theories and thoughts, really. But it seemed to me what I learned most of all from giving people sections of this screenplay to read at a time was actually later on, they genuinely were forgetting things that they thought earlier on
mm-hmm.
and had moved on totally mm-hmm. in their interpretation and had lost their connection to the earlier one. And I'm very interested to see how over the full 25 days of The Ticking World,
mm-hmm.
how connected people remain to what the world looks like and what the story seems to be in the first 5 days, as opposed to the next 10 days, as opposed to the 10 days after mm-hmm. that, because things do change. It's part of the format that you get to stop and reflect on where you are.
And do you think is there a way that you can get that feedback from people who are starting to use it? And is there an online presence for the calendar?
At the moment, it just has a couple of social media accounts
sure.
run by me. I'm wondering how I'm going to engage more. I think one of the things, asking people to keep a sketch pad or a notepad, I think them taking notes is very interesting, but I kind of do want to encourage them to sketch too, and sort of create their own sort of imitative sort of image, not imitative, but sort of parallel images to what Maya's done. So instead of sketching the element of the day that she's drawn, maybe do another one or so. I think that might be quite an interesting thing to see, because a lot of this is, I think it's true of all illustrated stories, really, in that a lot more happens than is in the illustration, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's like trying to depict a scene from a movie with one frame from a movie. So I think that if people do keep some sort of record as they go along, it'll be absolutely fascinating to see it. But for me, the most important thing is that they just enjoy the way that they interact mm-hmm. with it, really. Mm-hmm. As much as I'd like to see anybody who's listening mm-hmm. to this and then who reads The Ticking World, I absolutely would love to see any notes or images you create as you're mm-hmm. going through. But really the important thing is not me seeing them, but the act of making them and the enjoyment that comes out of making them.
Yeah, that's it. It just occurs to me, it might be quite fun for people to come up with a drawing or some impression of what their explorer looks like, because they don't necessarily have to be a human. And if you choose it to be a human, it could be a quite cartoony looking human and all sorts of things. You could go quite creative with it, I think would be quite fun.
I think so. And even the first page, not to give anything away, introduces another character who is not visualized.
Mm-hmm.
And I imagine and hope that the reads all manner of things for that character, really.
Yeah, good fun. So I think that the big important question is where is this going to be available? Where can people get a copy of the Ticking World calendar?
So we shopped around to try and find a publisher for this, and people who published calendars were not interested because there's nothing else like it. So maybe in the future, you'll be able to walk into a branch of big bookshop or department store here and pick it up. But at the moment, we've self-published this, and you have to buy it from us directly. So we've set up an Etsy shop, and all of the links are available through a Twitter account called The Ticking World. So if you go to at The Ticking World, you can see some images, you can find some links, you can engage with us and perhaps even get some hints. And we can direct you to where you can order The Ticking World, and we will post it to you. As I said, Paula, I'm interested in seeing if people want some sort of digital version of this. And if they do, then I'll try and find a way to make that possible. But first and foremost, there will be, you know, hopefully these hanging on people's walls this December. And that's the idea. So that we've got physical copies in hand. They're quite substantial. It's after you pick up a sort of a 12-leaf calendar, you get some sort of sense that they're quite wispy, really, but there's a bit more depth to this. But it is designed to comfortably and happily hang on a nail on the wall, or however you want to, the picture hook, however you want to suspend it. It has a calendar binding, so it hangs that way. And if you want to sit it on a tabletop or any other way, then that works too.
Very nice.
What I will say is, at this stage, if people are looking to buy this internationally, then move fast, because international postage times are really bad at the moment.
For sure.
Especially awful.
Yeah. Well, I will get all of the relevant links in the show notes wherever this is going to be, and share it on our socials as well, so people can quite easily find those links.
Thank you.
I must say, Brendan, as well, I do appreciate, because you went on a really interesting tangent there earlier about the state of cinema today, and I just appreciate that your thoughts on that, because I haven't really talked to anybody about that kind of thing, and I think we're of one mind with a lot of those issues. So I just wanted to put that out there, because it's not really something I've managed to discuss with anybody. It just hasn't come up before. So I do appreciate you making those analogies as well. And
right.
I feel like you had something to get off your chest there. So I'm glad you feel like you could do that here.
I spent 20 years writing about film as a film journalist. In fact, more than that, but I spent 20 years doing it sort of more or less as my job. And it seemed like for most of that time, we were on the cusp of a revolution where sort of access to films at home was going to become more and more possible. And several times in the past, it seemed like film studios and distributors were really going to try this. And of course, they were sort of catalyzed into doing it a lot more during the pandemic, but it's still exploratory, and the sort of models of how it works haven't quite lined up. But the one thing I found quite interesting about this was the decision to pull The Green Knight from its original cinema release date created a lot of furore in the UK audiences about it being pulled from cinemas. And they were like, what's going on? What's going on? And then they were like, oh, it's going straight to streaming. Oh, because the rumor was going around that it was going straight to streaming, and people were quite cross and frustrated about this. And of course, Paula, what happened when the film was then released simultaneously in cinemas and on streaming is that the majority of these people who'd kicked up a fuss watched it on streaming anyway. And I don't quite understand why people feel like they need to be held hostage to the cinema to go to the cinema. You either want to go to the cinema or you don't. And if you don't really, why do you need all of our avenues removed? I don't understand the psychology of it, but I think that's what we're really dealing with, is a sort of an audience that says cinema is dominant, cinema is preferable, and it is preferable in so many ways, but it's not functional at the moment.
Yeah.
Again, in multiple ways, but largely because the presentation is so bad. If people want to go to the cinema, they should just go to the cinema. It really is that simple, rather than try and make everybody else go to the cinema. I don't understand the logic, but anyway, yes, definitely something frustrating me. And as somebody who shielded throughout the pandemic has a degenerative lung condition, is quite concerned about people in a similar position, or people who don't have a lot of mobility or the option to always leave home, being treated like a different class of audience. But there you go.
Yeah.
Cinema will prevail. Even if they all closed down, they would open again. I guarantee it.
Yeah, because it offers a totally different experience. But I agree with some of the points you made earlier that I just have such sensitive hearing that I can't cope with other people's noise while I'm trying to be immersed in a film.
Right.
And that was a real problem for me. I wasn't going to the cinema as much anymore before the pandemic, partly because of it. I just couldn't cope with people having a catch up during A Quiet Place, or, you know, really munching through popcorn during really inappropriate serious films, you know, just stuff like that. I was other people's behaviors I was really struggling with, as well as how much it was costing.
Yes.
For all of those reasons, I mean, I have felt quite bad for not wanting to go back in a way. And cinema is a great, that's similar to you. It's the great love of my life.
You absolutely should not.
Yeah. Yeah.
You absolutely should not. It's you just listed a string of legitimate reasons why they're not delivering what they should. In the 1990s, I programmed films for a cinema for a while, and I put some silent films on the program. And I mean, actually silent, not accompanied by music, but genuinely silent.
Oh, I'd love that.
And audiences did not know what to do. They didn't know to just shut up. They just couldn't cope with it. And this was audiences at what one might call an art house cinema. And, you know, the best known of these films was Metropolis. This is not an obscure or difficult film. This is an incredibly accessible, crowd-pleasing film, but for the fact that it doesn't have conventional soundtrack in any sense. In fact, we played it truly silently, and the audience just couldn't shut up. And I don't know what it is, and there's some sort of conditioning towards noise, I think. Maybe it's intuitive, but I can sit at home and watch a film without talking to anybody. I don't fall apart. So I don't quite know why people, when there's more to lose, when there are other people there who have made an effort, paid money, or entitled to watch a film as it was intended to be seen, can't just shut the hell up. You know, I don't have an issue with somebody going to sit in the back row of, I don't know, Le Mepris or something you wouldn't expect them to be eating popcorn, as long as they're quiet about it.
Yeah.
It's really not difficult. But there's light pollution as much as sound pollution so much these days as well. So many cameras and things like that, phones coming out.
Well, it's good to have a wee rant about these things and just clear the air.
Well, there's your branching narrative for you. We have branched off into a completely different podcast.
Oh, I love it. Oh, Brendan, it's just so lovely to speak to you again. I always really enjoy our time together, and it feels like you're an October regular fast becoming, so you're welcome back anytime.
Maybe that's it. Maybe this time next year, a whole new thing in a completely different medium. I think that's my ambition, Paula, is to talk to you once a year about something in a completely different medium.
Let's make it a deal. Happy with that. Well, thank you so much. It's been great, Brendan. Thanks.